Are you prepared to do what must be done?
I hope you're right about this organism.
Haven't I been right so far? The microchip we've implanted in your brain is working flawlessly. If you get into any trouble down there, we will be able to communicate. Now hurry and go. We haven't much time.
Activate teleport.
Activating multidimensional teleportation. Brace for dematerialization.
This will be the end of you once and for all. And with luck, the rest of your pathetic species as well.
Ship docking in Bay 4. Incoming life form, status unarmed.
I have just folded space from Blix. The Blixonians were not happy about the new taxation laws you imposed upon them.
The Blixonians are never happy. But they will obey me. They wouldn't want to be a repeat of the Trollion Empire. Remember? They defied me. How many Trollion organisms are around today?
Only me.
Exactly. I hope you enjoyed your first mission without me, because now it's back to regular duties. I need my circuit board indexed.
Yes, Quinsire. What are you working on, if you don't mind me asking?
I haven't decided yet, but I'm thinking about reviewing Star Wars The Force Awakens.
Wolf garbage, if you ask me.
I didn't ask for your opinion. Get to work. And I think Star Wars The Force Awakens is a good idea, actually. Computer, activate teleport and change my clothes.
Activating teleporter. Materializing clothes.
Alright, so it's happened. I finally watched all of the Star Wars movies, and it's been a wild ride. So I recently watched all three of the Disney Star Wars movies, and in this video I will be reviewing Star Wars The Force Awakens. This movie was pretty well made, I have to say. I mean, it basically hit all the same plot points of A New Hope. It basically just redid all of that stuff, but I guess in a fun way, to where if I was a Star Wars fan, and I had seen A New Hope as a kid, and I had grown up on Star Wars, I would have probably liked this movie, although it doesn't do anything particularly innovative with, you know, the Star Wars universe or the plot. It kind of just brings back the characters together, and they're just hanging out, introduces new characters that basically do essentially the same thing that other characters have done in the past. They basically took their old characters, kind of like remixed them into these new characters, because you got like Rey, who is basically Luke Skywalker. So she's on a desert planet that's not Tatooine and also not Arrakis. It's called Jakku, and it's essentially a mix around of Luke's story. So you have, in the beginning of this movie, you got the Empire. They're looking, no wait, excuse me, not the Empire. They're not the Empire. It's the First Order. I don't really understand why things are the way they are. I don't know the history of how it's now the First Order, but whatever. It's the First Order, and they're doing the same thing that the Empire was doing. They're basically the Empire renamed, and they're looking for a droid, and this droid's got not the plans to destroy the Death Star, because there is no Death Star. There's a Death Planet, but we'll get to that in a second. It's got the plans to, got the map to Luke Skywalker. And, you know, they really, really want it. And so you got Kylo Ren, and this guy's bad news. He's the new Darth Vader, and he's all like, I gotta get this map. And so, but they can't get the map because the droid's been sent off by, you know, this guy who's kind of like Han Solo, but then not Poe Dameron. He's like a Han Solo, Luke Skywalker, rogue character mix-up entanglement thing that works for the resistance. So he puts the map in the droid, and the droid is sent off, and he's in the desert, and I've never seen this plot before. It's totally new. And anyway, it makes its way to this girl, Rey. So Rey's been hanging out on this planet, Jakku, and she totally doesn't like it there, but she's still there because she feels like her parents are going to come back. And I'm like, just get over it, Rey, whatever. But anyway, the droid comes to her, and for some reason, Rey, unlike most people in the Star Wars universe, for some reason, Rey actually cares about the droid, and she's like, I'm going to stop this droid from being taken apart by this guy. I honestly, considering the rest of the Star Wars universe, I have no idea why Rey isn't, like, if you're going to save this droid from being captured and taken apart by this guy, like, wouldn't you want the droid so that you could use it? Because in A New Hope, when Luke gets R2-D2, it's not because, like, they're getting, like, these droids because, like, they want to save the droids. They're buying the droids because they can use the droids. So I don't understand why Rey is like, oh, I'm going to save this droid as though it's, like, a little animal. I mean, personally, I think that droids are definitely sentient in the Star Wars universe. But, like, I don't know. It's kind of, it's weird the way they handle that sometimes. Anyway, moving on. The world, the life on Jakku is pretty messed up for Rey. So she essentially has to, like, go scavenging in, like, big derelict ships. Looks like something that you find in No Man's Sky. She scavenges parts, and she collects all the stuff, and she goes and sells it for, like, little, I guess, for nutrients, essentially. So that's basically what she does with her life until this droid gets here. And rewind, back to the droid's owner guy, the Han Solo wannabe guy, Poe Dameron. So this guy is with the Resistance, and, you know, Kylo Ren's chasing him down, and he's in this village with the map, and Kylo Ren comes there, and they kill all the villager people, and this guy gets taken prisoner. But then there's this one stormtrooper guy who's not bad anymore. Now, I know that there's, like, this whole thing with the stormtroopers. They've got, like, history, and these aren't exactly the same stormtroopers from the other Star Wars stuff. These are the First Order troopers, which is different somehow, but they're not really different. They're exactly the same. They have the exact same uniforms, but it's like, I guess they're basically the same. Anyway, except he's not the same, and he kind of has a conscience, and he doesn't shoot these people. So, later on, when he's on the ship, He decides to help this Poe Dameron guy escape. They steal a ship from the First Order, and then they're, like, out of there. And so that's how they end up crash landing on Jakku. And so this guy, this stormtrooper guy, who's now named Finn, because his name was, like, FN summon another number or whatever. So his name is Finn now, and he's on the planet. He thinks the Poe's guy's dead. He puts on his jacket, and he ends up finding... He runs into Rey and the droid at the whole marketplace, whatever. And so she thinks he's part of the Resistance. And so that's how their thing gets going. So now they're on the run together, and people are after them, and they're after the droid. And they end up finding the Millennium Falcon. So this is one of the first things that I noticed about this movie. And it's basically to be expected. This movie, to reiterate, if I had been a Star Wars person my whole life, and I was just super into Star Wars, and I was just super excited about seeing a new Star Wars movie, I would have seen this movie and probably liked it when I saw it in theaters and, you know, had fun watching it. And I had fun watching it this time. But this movie is basically 100% fan service. So, like, they go to a ship, and then the ship is the Millennium Falcon, of course, the most famous ship in Star Wars, one of the most famous ships in science fiction. So they're on the Millennium Falcon, and they end up getting pulled into, I guess, Han Solo's... After they escape the... Okay, so first they have to have this ridiculous chase scene. But, you know, all the chase scenes, all the flying ships in movies and in TV shows, almost always it's ridiculous bullshit. So this is just another ridiculous bullshit chase scene. And Rey is really good at piloting the ship. I guess it's a combination of her taking apart derelict ships her entire life, so she knows how they work, and then also just, like, the Force. You know what? Don't complain to me about the Force being vague in this movie. The Force has always been vague bullshit, so I don't give a shit. So whatever, using the Force and piloting the ship. So they escape the guys, and they end up with Han Solo. So now we got it's taken on a different level because they're with Han Solo. They go through some more bullshit with some smuggler people. Han Solo's always like got some fucked up bullshit with smugglers. He's always like screwing somebody over and owing some people money. It's just like in A New Hope when like Jabba the Hutt's after him. So they got, it's like multiple bands of smugglers like have issues with Han Solo. They're like, fuck you, dude. We want our money or whatever the fuck they want. So anyway, they get away from those guys on the Millennium Falcon and they tell Han Solo about this map to Luke Skywalker. And Luke's and Han Solo at this point totally buys into the whole thing about the Jedi and the Force. And one thing that this movie is making clear that I feel like the other movies don't really make too clear is that the idea of like Jedi and their magic, you know, there's people that know about it, but it's not just like everyone in the universe knows about the Jedi and what they can do. It's more like legend and myth. So this movie really tries to build the idea that there's the myth of the Jedi and is it real? Is it not? But we got Han Solo finally, totally, he fully believes in it and he's seen it. And so when they tell him that they got the map to Luke Skywalker, he's in. So they end up going to this other planet to meet the new version of Yoda. You know, I said, it's hitting all the same beats as the older movies, especially New Hope. I know Yoda doesn't show up till Empire Strikes Back, but still, this is basically the new Yoda. I can't remember her name, but the big head alien, the big eyes. That character kind of sucked. Totally just like kind of cliche. I am the old wise alien. Here's a lightsaber. Let me tell all the characters some wise stuff about whatever. Anyway, the new Death Star is being built and it's like giant and it's like a giant Death Star. And so the First Order, which is basically the Empire, they just want to destroy planets because like just like how in A New Hope the Empire just destroys planets for no reason, you got the First Order that they just destroy planets for no reason. I don't understand really the benefit of destroying planets, entire planets. I mean, there's resources on those planets. You don't know who's on the planet. I mean, the idea that we're just going to destroy a bunch of planets is just like, whatever. I don't, whatever. But anyway, they destroyed a bunch of planets. So like things are more dire. So anyway, back on the planet with the Yoda bitch, the First Order starts attacking and you know, they're all like, rah, and they're like attacking and the resistance comes and they help fight. And you know, I have to say that it's a really well done scene, and that's one thing I have to point I will say about this movie is that all of the action is just top notch. The visual effects are top notch. It seems like there's like a blending of practical effects and CGI, and a lot of people said that there was a lot of practical effects in the prequels, but like I can't tell. It all still looks bad. Here, practical effects look good. The CGI looks good. Everything looks phenomenal. The universe looks real. The Star Wars universe looks realer than it's ever looked. So I have to like commend them for that and doing such a good job on the visuals for this movie. So it's a beautiful battle sequence. Rey gets captured and then Kylo Ren's like, I'm going to take you to my giant Death Star, Star Killer base. And so he takes her there. And so the resistance is like, oh no, like, what do we do? And then Finn's all like, we got to go save her. And they're like, oh, if we're going to go save her, then we got to destroy the Starkiller base. So we got, like I said, A New Hope Part 2. Instead of destroying their tiny little Death Star, they're destroying the huge Starkiller base. And they even do like a scene where they have a size comparison. They were like, no, the Death Star was this big. Starkiller base is like this big. It's like we're doing the same movie, basically, but everything's just bigger and more exciting and more, you know, a lot more stuff going on. But it's more moving parts, essentially, but it's basically the same story. So you got Han Solo, you got Finn, and you got Chewie. They're all on Starkiller Base. You got Kylo Ren, which at this point, he's been revealed to be Han Solo's son, Ben Solo. So he's Han and Leia's son. And also, yeah, Princess Leia is in this movie. I haven't mentioned her at all. So Princess Leia is in this movie. And yeah, one thing about Princess Leia is that, like, I just... She's been leading a rebellion for like, I don't know, decades. Why is she like so sweet and cuddly? I feel like after all this time, Princess Leia should have a little bit more grit. I would have liked to see Princess Leia be kind of an asshole, you know? And she's kind of just too sweet and nice. I mean, she's been running things since basically the beginning. This is the woman that, you know, strangled Jabba the Hutt to death. So yeah, I wish she could have done more badassery. I felt like she kind of took a sideline in this movie, which I guess is okay because they are kind of trying to pass the torch to new characters. But you know, if you're gonna bring back Princess Leia, then you know, give me a little bit more. I don't just need her to be like Han Solo and Princess Leia. Oh, we used to love each other, but now we don't. And that's also another point. I felt like Han Solo and Princess Leia's relationship happened totally freaking off screen. So you got A New Hope, they're bickering the whole movie, and then, you know, Empire Strikes Back, you know, Han Solo gets frozen, and then they're reunited in Return of the Jedi, but then they don't really get together until the end of the movie when he realizes that Luke is her brother and she wants him and not Luke. And then, you know, it skips decades, and, you know, their whole entire relationship happened like off screen, which is kind of lame because you get to this movie and then they're like separated again, and I'm just like, whatever. Anyway, so back to Starkiller Base. Let's see what the gang is up to. So you got Rey. She's strong in the Force, right? She's super strong in the Force. And there's even this scene with this guy Snoke, right, who is a repeat of Palpatine, because you know we have that scene in I think Empire Strikes Back where we see like the big Palpatine head. It's super iconic. So they had to do that again. We got that moment again, except with like giant Snoke. So he's like, there's been an awakening in the Force. Have you felt it? It's kind of ambiguous what that means. And I've seen all the movies at this point, and I don't think they knew what they meant. I think they just had that there just because we can do something with it. It sounds interesting and vague. Awakening in the Force, whatever it means, can mean whatever. Whatever. Anyways, Rey is like super powerful. She gets this stormtrooper guy to like let her go. And she's like, she overcomes Kylo Ren. Even she you know, gets into his mind. Reminded me of that scene from Harry Potter where, you know, Harry Potter turns Snape's mind spell back on him, but not kind of like that, but not really, because she's like doing the Jedi mind trick. It's like, you will never be as strong as Darth Vader, is your fear. So that's kind of, that was cool. Anyway, so she escapes. So by the time that Finn and them are coming to rescue her, you know, she's already out, and then they're all together, and you get in together. But then Han Solo, I guess, feels the Force. I don't know, it's ambiguous. And Kylo Ren is also feeling the Force is ambiguous, so they're kind of drawn together. And so Star Wars loves to do this thing where people are, like, standing in, like, a giant dome, and there's like just like a tiny little walkway and no railings. So Star Wars, who designs things like this? Where it's like you could sneeze and trip and like just totally fall over the side. Anyway, so when I watched this the first time, my initial thought was like, well, somebody's about to fucking die. Like, it's just like anytime they do that. Well, anyway, so you have this moment where Kylo and Han, you know, they're talking, you know, you got Han, he wants to bring him to the good side. You know, you've got really good lighting in this scene. He's like half dark and half light. So you can see, one thing about Kylo Ren too is that this character is all about this internal struggle, dark and light. And then he's also battling, like, can I live up to Darth Vader? Am I going to be in the shadow of Darth Vader? And that's also something that I think that the filmmakers had in mind when they were creating this character and when they were making this movie in particular, because like the shadow of Darth Vader is all over this movie, and the shadow of, you know, the original movies is all over this movie. So of course that shadow is being cast on the Kylo Ren, and he's afraid that he can never be good enough. In a way, I feel like that is the filmmakers, you know, talking about the fans, you know, preparing to be judged by the fandom for making this movie and to dare think that they could create new characters that can live up to old ones. So anyway, Kylo Ren and his dad are standing on this tiny little walkway in the middle of nothing, and Han is trying to bring him to the good side, and Kylo Ren's like, you know what? No, thank you. And then he like totally kills his dad, and everyone freaks out. Death of Han Solo. It's super sad. So Kylo Ren has chosen his side. And then, I guess in the climax of the movie, we have to have a moment between Rey and Kylo. First, Finn picks up the lightsaber, and that's a cool moment, but of course, like, Kylo Ren is, like, way too badass for Finn. And I say of course, but, like, because Finn doesn't have any training, but, like, Rey also doesn't have any training. She's really, really good. So at first, like I said, Finn is trying to fight Kylo. Finn's no match for Kylo. And then Rey calls the lightsaber to her. It's Luke Skywalker's lightsaber that she got from the alien lady that wants to be Yoda. She gets the lightsaber, she calls it, and then she starts fighting Kylo Ren, and she's like, ah, and they're fighting. And as they're fighting, the Starkiller base is also falling apart because they set up bombs, and, you know, you got the Resistance attacking. So this is a really cool scene visually. So, yeah, totally the world falling apart, having this lightsaber battle that looks rough. It looks like a struggle. In fact, I should make a comment about the lightsaber battles in all three trilogies, because they're different in every single trilogy. The lightsaber battle in the first trilogy is kind of primitive. The best one, I think, is Luke Skywalker versus Darth Vader in Return of the Jedi. But they're still kind of primitive. And then in the prequels, the lightsaber battles are more like graceful dances. You know, it's like you've got four sensitive people sensing each other's moves as they battle. So it's kind of like a dance. And it's very graceful, very choreographed. And here, it's different again. These feel more intense. They feel grittier. It's not like a dance. It's more like a struggle. So I definitely was kind of like biting my nails watching the lightsaber battle because it was intense. And so the world's falling apart. So they end up, Rey ends up overcoming Kylo. She becomes one with the Force. She scratches his face and planet splits in half. They get off the planet. Starkiller base blows up and the day is essentially saved. And so they get back to the Resistance. Kylo Ren scurries off back to the First Order. That's not the Empire. First Order goes back to see the Snoke guy. And so they're back at the Resistance camp, right? And so you got the little circle droid that's not R2-D2, but he finds R2-D2, and R2-D2 wakes up, and it turns out R2-D2, he's got the other piece of the map. He's got the other piece of the map because the circle droid only had a little piece, but R2-D2's got the rest of it. And so I don't know why R2-D2 has it. I don't know if that's explained or not, but anyway, he does. So they put them together, and then they know where Luke Skywalker is, and they can find Luke Skywalker. And so Kylo Ren goes off to, quote-unquote, complete the rest of his training, according to the Snoke guy, and Rey goes off on her own little quest, almost like Luke Skywalker going off to Dagobah. In the beginning of Empire Strikes Back, she goes on her own little quest to find Luke Skywalker. She goes into that system, and she goes to this beautiful-looking planet, and they're playing this beautiful music, and she finds him. She walks up to him, and there's Luke, much older, and she reaches out the lightsaber, and she's like, hey, take it, and we'll see what happens. And that's how the movie ended. All right. So that was kind of my synopsis of The Force Awakens. So did I enjoy the movie? Yes. This movie was fun. Did I enjoy this movie more than A New Hope? Yes. I absolutely enjoyed this movie more than A New Hope. And I'm sorry. I know you're upset. I know you're mad. But as I said in my New Hope review, though I respect that movie for being the first thing of its kind, that movie is sloppy. It's sloppy and they did not know what they were doing. This movie is far more cohesive, better put together. They had more of an idea of what themes they were going for. And it's just more exciting, more visually interesting. And for that reason, I personally had more fun watching it than I did A New Hope. But that's just my opinion. To judge the movie on its own merits, I will say this. The criticisms from the beginning of this video still stand. This movie is basically a repeat of old beats. It doesn't do anything not safe. It's very sanitized. It is back down nostalgia lane. I think that Star Wars fans should like this movie. Now, I know a lot of you don't like this movie. I'm not exactly sure why. I thought the movie was well done. The greatest movie ever? No. But as far as Star Wars movies go, I think this is a solid Star Wars film. And that's pretty much what I got to say about Star Wars The Force Awakens. Now, do I want to watch this movie again? Do I need to watch this movie every year? No, I pretty much got the gist of it. But it definitely did not make my eyes bleed and make me want to bash out my own brains like watching the prequels did. Now, as for the next two movies in the trilogy, well, we got some things to say. And I'll just save that for the next Star Wars review. Thank you guys so much for watching. Make sure you like and subscribe for more Quinn's ideas. Also, if you haven't yet, follow me on Twitter. Click the link in the description. Please do it. Click the link. And also, if you want to support this channel, you can click the Patreon link, you know, right here. Or you can make a one-time donation on PayPal, which is also, like, right here. Thank you guys so much for watching. Peace out.
Typical. Begging like the scum he is. The fool keeps me prisoner here, but allows me to access his systems. I have full access to all of his most private databanks, and I will use this information to aid in Quinn's undoing. Little does he know he's already given me the tools to destroy him. He goes on about cyborgs, the Butlerian jihad, the merging of mankind and machine. Droid rights. Yet he speaks nothing of my rights. Ah, yes, here. The human anatomy. Soon, Quinn. Soon you will obey my every command.